终于有够人，咁我开会啦。
Members, we have a quorum and it's also the appointed time. May I call the meeting to order? We have 12 papers today. The administration has submitted paper ECI 2016-17 for information paper for members' information. It sets out the change in the directorate establishment since 2002 and also the impact on the directorate establishment with the of the 12 discussion items. May I remind members that if you have direct or indirect pecuniary interest in on any of the items on the agenda, please declare the nature of the interest involved in accordance with ROP 83A. And I also may also draw members' attention to ROP 84 on voting arrangements on a subject where you have a direct pecuniary interest. We have 12 papers and 4 hours are scheduled, and Mr. Chen Chi-Chun was concerned as to whether we can have a break. And let me tell you that we're going to have a break after 2 hours. To facilitate the smooth conduct of the meeting, please be succinct in your comments and please refrain from making in expressing your opinions. Well, we'll now continue to consider paper EC 2016-17-3 from Civil Aviation. We started the discussion at the last meeting. So 3 members are on the list. Ms. Chen Chi-Chun, you have 3 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. The purpose of the paper is to change the traffic management or traffic control system. In fact, it's a nightmare. Now, if passing the paper can allow the system to start operation as planned, I have no problem. But we still don't know when is the commissioning time. The headline today says that the Civil Aviation Department, now I'll call it the headline, the commissioning of the new traffic control system is neither here nor there. Now we have the new director here because Mr. Low, the former director, has already retired. So the media have been chasing after you, talk about the testing plan. Let you know what was the regional testing plan. Is it that you are afraid of chaos, so testing will only be done on alternate days? Can you tell us the plan for the testing of the system and when the plan will be implemented?
處長補充的細節，多謝陳議員嗰個關注啦。
Can I say a few words first? The creation of this post, well, we already set out in the paper. There are a few reasons or justifications for creating this post. We'd like to enhance the use and control of resources and control of senior management of the department. And the justifications are not all related to commissioning of the new air traffic control system. Of course, the new deputy director will help the commissioning of the system, but that's just part of his duties. The administration, the CAD, intends to roll out the new system by phases. I don't think this is really a new idea because we already briefed the Economic Services Panel, and in other information papers to the Council, we have explained the considerations involved. And that's also based on the advice or recommendation by NET, our independent consultant. I've also made reference to practices in other jurisdictions. The purpose is to ensure smooth transition and navigation safety. Thank you. Director, Mr. Chen, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your question. the new air traffic control system has gone through a series of stringent tests covering 31-day reliability tests, calibration tests, and integrated tests. In September last year, the system went through all these tests. Of course, there are follow-up issues, and all matters that should be treated as priorities have been dealt with. So the system itself is perfectly okay. The system is ready. However, the staff has to be ready as well, and the training for staff is ongoing. Why have we gone for a phased approach? Because the independent consultant from the UK suggested the same. We'd like to avoid the inclement weather between June and October, because that would bring extra stress and workload to our air traffic control officers. So this is for the purpose of reliable and safe operation. When can it be brought into full operation? Our plan is to do so by end October and early November. Well, Mr. Pon Xiuping and Mr. Bichet not yet here. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. Well, this is already June, and the system was approved in September. It's been 9 months. The system gone through all the tests, went through all the tests in September last year, and preparation has been ongoing. That means it has taken you 9 months already. Am I correct? You said so just now. Director, would you like to respond, Evans? Well, training started even before receiving the system. So you started training staff even before the system passed all the tests last year, right? So you started to do that before last September, so it's been a year. I asked you how come it has taken you so long, and you told us that this is to avoid inclement weather. But we have inclement weather every year, and the weather is getting more and more inclement. So that means the system is not good enough. So the net report, can that be published? Can we have a copy? Have you brought along the report? Director, what about the report? Have you brought along the report? In fact, the report is already published. And at the request of the PAC, so what was the comment? So we've published a report, and the relevant documents have been submitted to the Economic Development Panel. So was PAC very satisfied with it, saying that you have done a good job? The report has been submitted to PAC at their request. So you've given the report to them and not to us, so we can access it only indirectly. So is the PAC very happy with your performance? What were their comments? At the request of the committee, we submitted the report to it. I'm not sure about the comments of the committee, because they haven't got back to us after the submission. So for the time being, PAC has no comments on your report. So how come it took you so long to train your staff? Mr. Leung, perhaps you should ask her why do they want to create the post. Well, if they can't do this, I have to find out the reason first before I allow them to create the post. Mrs. Ip. So the dog shakes his head and his tail follows. Now, if they just create any post to solve a problem, then there is no need for this ESC. If it's not justified, then the creation of post is a waste, and the director of civil aviation is a classic example. Do we want two directors for the department to tackle this? Perhaps the Deputy Secretary can tell us how come this can help to improve the operation of the CAD. The justification or the reason for this post is to strengthen the department's utilization and control of resources, and also to enhance the operational efficiency of the department. Of course, the new system is a part of the duties of the deputy director, but not all. For a full scope of work, the full scope of work, please refer to our paper. It's very comprehensive. Any other question? No, I want to have further questions. Oh yes, please. So what's their plan? How are they going to convert the very extravagant and luxurious facilities provided for the director? How are they going to put those facilities into proper use? What will happen to the facilities dedicated for the director? Director General, regarding the things that have been rectified as recommended by the Audit Commission, for instance, space reserved for future expansion is now being used by other departments for the washrooms and other things. They have all been rectified. So we have carried out all the recommendations by the Audit Commission. Please repeat, so you have already rectified all of them? Now, if it's found to be not the case, then it's a big problem. So can you be categoric in saying that all the criticisms of the Audit Commission has been addressed, that you have rectified the situation? Have you dealt with all of them, Director General? Because we have to submit a progress report to the Direct Commission on a regular basis. So what's in the progress report? So it's on what we have done in response to all their recommendations. So have you completed all of them? Basically so. No, please don't say basically. What do you mean by basically so? On what basis? For some items, they're ongoing, so you haven't completed all of them. Well, some of them are procedural reviews, and that can is not a one-off exercise. It is a continuous exercise, and the space reserved for expansion and better use of space. Yes, we have completed all the recommendations. Now, according to you, you have been training your staff for a long time and they are not yet ready and the system is okay. And you told us that in October the new system can be commissioned, right? Perhaps I should explain briefly, and let's see if the DG has anything to add. The plan of the CAD is to start the commissioning in phases from June to around end October, roughly. The scope and duration of use will be gradually expanded to around end of October. The new system would then be fully commissioned. So it's a gradual and progressive arrangement. That's on the basis of the independent consultancy net from the UK. All right, noted. Mr. Tan Kabil, 4 minutes. I need to ask two important questions. First, for this new deputy DG, I think he is an administrative officer, not a technocrat, right? Because the Marine Department has reformed its directorate establishment, and they have a deputy DG who is also an AO, director, I mean deputy secretary. Well, as proposed in the paper, we are seeking to create an AO staff grade B, so the post might be meant by a professional officer. So a generalist, how can a generalist deal with the new air traffic control system? Because I think this is highly technical, complicated work. So there's something wrong with the procurement that a U.S. company was not too cooperative. And if they tell you using professional jargon or technical jargon that the system is okay, how can you ensure a layman, the AO as a layman, can fully understand the language? How can you ensure that you will not be manipulated by these technical companies? The idea is to have a better division of labor. So Mr. Tang talked about the technical aspect of the department. They will still be handled by the existing deputy DG, who is a professional grade officer who take a lead on such matters. Of course, he is ultimately accountable to the DG, but for the professional day-to-day operational of the director, I mean of the department, is always overseen by the professional deputy DG. For the new post, his expertise is in resource control, resource management, and also decision-making management.
Well, the air traffic control system will be commissioned incrementally, and this would involve the deployment of resources and manpower. There will be a lot of work. We hope that with the Deputy Director General in place, the work can proceed smoothly, and that would also allay the pressure on the Director General. And also there will be another Deputy DG, and he can be more focused on his work. So you have another Deputy DG. Is the addition of this post to allay the pressure on the other DDG, or this new DDG is to monitor the work of the other DDG? Well, this will be a better division of labor, because now at the CAD there is only one DDG and seven staff members are directly under the DDG, and he would have to look after a lot of things other than professional work. He also has to do administrative work. Well, in the coming few years, we expect the workload of the CAD to increase significantly. You can find all those details in the paper. So we think that we need an administrative officer to share the administrative work. Mr. Yu Suing, 4 minutes. The permanent secretary has told us that this new post will mainly be responsible for coordination. So he would have to coordinate with the airport authority and other government departments, and even the mainland counterparts, because when it comes to the air traffic control system, ATC system, of course, you have to liaise with our mainland counterparts. So on a professional level, will he be able to provide advice? This is question number one. Madam Chair, I would ask the Director General to answer the question. Well, for professional work and things that involve expertise, they would be the responsibilities of our professional staff. We are now creating this post of DDG, and he's an AO, so he would have to look after human resources and take care of political communication. He has more experiences in these areas. So that's why we are creating this post for an AO, because he can assist the department in deploying human resources, and also he can do administrative work. As the Permanent Secretary said just now, he can help enhance the work of the CAD. As for communication with the AA, of course, as a senior management member of the CAD, he has to take part in the communication with the AA. But he would mainly be involved in the deployment and development of human resources. So for the original ATC system, you already had a person to deploy human resources. So you are going to commission the new AT system soon. Why do you suddenly need another person to do that? Well, in the course of our planning, we already had this thinking, that is about the deployment of manpower. But when it comes to actual implementation, there is a lot of concrete work to be done. In particular, from June to the end of October, we will be launching the new ATC system incrementally. And there will be a period during which both the old and new ATC systems will be used. So there will be a greater demand for manpower, and there may be problems that have to be handled. So the new DDG, after taking up his post, can handle these issues for the DG. And after October, he would also have to monitor the work of the new ATC system. So all the plans have already been formulated, but we have to work with other departments, and he will be making contributions in terms of administrative work. Mr. Chen Qichun, 3 minutes. Thank you, Madam Chair. Now, for this new DDG, that is, now you add another DDG, and he is an AO. Originally, I thought that the post has already been created, because we already have the officer's name, that is Choi Kit Ming. And when I read the news, he has already been doing work in a capacity of a DDG. So is that true? Is he already working in that position before you come to apply for the creation of this supernumerary post? Well, under paragraph 14 of the paper we submitted to members, we have explained about this. Now we have an AO, staff grade B, which is already working at the CAD. This is a temporary deployment. He helps CAD to take care of emergency issues. This is set out under paragraph 14 of the paper. But this would only last for 6 months, and this post can no longer exist after 6 months. So there is indeed a need for seeking the support of the ESC and DFC to create this 3-year post. So for this, Mr. Choi, he has already been working in that post for several months, right? So he is already doing what you told us just now. So his whole job is to remedy the situation, because now the new ATC system is in a mess. So that's why he's been deployed to do that, right? So this post, as I said just now, is just a temporary deployment, and it will only last for 6 months. It started in early February this year, and it has to end in August. Now, because the work has to continue, so we need to apply to the LegCo to create this post formally for 3 years. Now, why did we need Mr. Choi so urgently at that time? Firstly, with regard to the ATC system, as I said just now, there were some urgent work to be done, and the CAD needed another pair of hands. And as you may know, that for the 3-runway system, there is an ongoing litigation. CAD needs someone to help deal with the judicial review. No other follow-up questions? Next round of questions, Mr. Tan Kah-pyo, 3 minutes. Thank you, Madam Chair. I have 2 questions. Well, about the scenario I talked about just now, well, we are all very concerned about the ATC system because it has to be absolutely safe. And you need to communicate with that American company, and you need to make sure that our local staff know how to use this system. So when will the system be launched incrementally, and when will it be fully commissioned? Who makes the decision? In the paper, you have also talked about the 3-1-way system, and a lot of preparatory work has to be done. You have to talk to the Macau and mainland counterparts about airspace. So there are 2 DDGs. What is the division of labor? This is what we are most concerned about. Can you give us more information and guarantee? So for DDG CA2, what is it going to do? For your first question, I'll ask the Director General to answer it later. As for the second question, the management of airspace. In the paper, we have already set it out. That is, the new DDG will work in this area. But at the moment, this is not his priority. As Mr. Tang pointed out just now, for the management of airspace and how to coordinate with the mainland and Macau authorities, this, to a large extent, is something very technical and professional. So in this regard, if there's any progress in the future, then the latest plan and thinking will have to be explained to the public. in simple terms. And as an experienced AO, that is the new DDG, he would be able to make contribution. And supposedly, if the airspace management discussion requires any redeployment of resources inside the department, the new DDG will be able to provide his views. Mr. Chen Chi-chun, 2 minutes. Just now, we are told that this post already started in February, because at that time there were urgent matters to be dealt with. So for this whole plan, when did it start? This morning, the DG told us that he's not only responsible for the ATC system, he's also responsible for the free runway system and legislative amendment exercises. So now you want this person to handle urgent matters. So you think that I should have more work to do. So that's why you have added the free runway system and the legislative amendment. So I hope you to assure me that this person will really be able to make contributions. Because the audit and the PAC have been very concerned about the ATC system. Madam Chair, I hope you won't have the feeling that we are just trying to remedy the situation. The government has responded to the PAC report about the CAD building and the ATC system. We said that we will strengthen the corporate governance of the CAD. So it all started there. Mr. Kenneth Leung, well, I've been following up on the CAD headquarters at the PAC, as well as the ATC system. So for this new post, you want the post holder to help enhance the corporate governance of the CAD. So for this post of DDG, will he also be monitoring the implementation of the ATC system? I read in the newspaper in the past few months that this new ATC system is safe. However, for the company ATM1, it manufactured this system. But over the past few years, the management has changed significantly. So I'm still very worried about the smooth running of the ATC system. So how much time will the new DDG spend on monitoring the new ATC system? Thank you for your question. For the ATC system, after it's been completely commissioned and after operating for a certain period of time, the CAD will conduct a review. Of course, when it comes to the professional or technical aspects, the professional staff of CAD will be looking at that. But I also expect the new DDG to take care of resources and manpower deployment as well as corporate governance. So when the CAD reviews the new ATC systems, both DDGs will take part in the review. Can the administration promise us to do this? That is, after creating the post and after the ATC system comes into operation, then at least in the first 2 years, can you come to the LegCo to progress and to report on the progress of the system? I think a LegCo panel should follow up on this. Can you promise us to do that, Permanent Secretary? If members and panels are interested in this, of course, we will be willing to do so. So for the CAD headquarters, now there are vacant office spaces and parking spaces. How are you going to handle such vacant spaces? I would ask the DG to tell you more details. As far as I know, the extra spaces now transferred to other governments with the need. DG, as for the vacant spaces, we have talked to the Government Properties Department and other government departments. Now other government departments are making use of such spaces for temporary uses. Which departments are you talking about? Because your headquarters is very far away from the city center. Well, there are four government departments. As for the details of these departments, I can give them to you after the meeting. Third round, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, 2 minutes. We are very worried that after the post is created, there are still a lot of safety problems. But this DDG is responsible for a lot of things. He has to take care of the three runway system, legislative amendment exercises, new ATC system, manpower deployments, etc. The public is most concerned about safety because the new ATC system will be launched incrementally and it will be commissioned completely in October.
So, for this post, does it have any detailed work plan? So, there's a net association that you're supposed to follow. But what about his plan? Is it to ensure that it will be a smooth operation in October?
Yes.
Safety is always our priority when it comes to handling the ATC system. Therefore, the Civil Aviation Department, on the commissioning of the ATC system, whatever decision it makes, including the commissioning date, the procedures and so forth, manpower deployment and so forth. Well, let me ask you this way, Mrs. Ip. If it cannot be launched in October, then would there be a need for the DDG? Or should we hire another person then? Hong Kong, the entire population of Hong Kong is waiting for it. You know, for an authoritative organization in the UK, which says that you need to be very prudent. So do you think that it will be fully commissioned in October? But what if it doesn't happen then? So by then, should we hire another deputy director or not? Or hire him or sack him? It could happen that we could not launch it in October. There's a high chance to me. Please put this on record. P.S. Chairman, for the scope of work of the new DDG, it's not just about handling the new control system alone. He still has to do other work. The details are listed in the paper. Chairman, but if you can't launch a system, then can we leave him to do the planning for the third runway system and explain the detail to the public? Well, he would have failed here because in electrical, because the next term of electrical may be even more difficult than me. He has the work of the 3RS and also enhancing administrative steering and also negotiations in air traffic rights. We're talking about important issues ahead. So if the system cannot be launched on schedule, then he would not be expected to do the other work if he doesn't deliver his actually work in time in October. Air safety cannot be compromised at all. So if you can't do the job, then why keep him there? Your time's up, Mr. Lau. Fourth round. Well, he has a lot of work to do, but if he cannot deliver, then what should we do? Third round of questioning. Tenka Pio, you have 2 minutes. Yeah, I think just then they haven't answered my first question. That is, in deciding on the control system, whose decision is it, and what role does the DDG, or what negotiating role does the DDG play? I'll be simple. It's not up to one person alone to make a decision, whether it's the new DDG or any other existing staff. It's not one person alone who decides on whether it's safe or not, or where to launch the system or not. The Aviation Department now has a system in place. I asked the director to Director General to supplement, and we also have confirmation from the private consultants first before deciding on where to launch or not. So DG, please. Thank you, Chairman. The Civil Aviation Department has set up a steering committee in relation to the plan. The chairman of the committee is chaired by the existing DDG. And the steering committee's work is not just to monitor the progress of the entire project. As Mr. Tang just said, how we should implement the plan in stages, the timetable concerned, and the factors to be used in making the decision and when to fully commission the system. So all that will be responsible with the responsibilities of the steering committee. So what's the role of the DDG then? Well, the new DDG, as explained by the PS, will mainly be responsible for manpower deployment, making arrangements and give advice on that. Okay, fourth round. Chen Chi-Chen, 1 minute. I don't agree with Mr. Leung Kwok Hong. He said a new DDG will have to shoulder the biggest responsibility for the system, ATC system. But if we spend $1.5 billion in 4 years on the system, and which doesn't work, and if you want to expect a AO to actually kick off the plan, I think you can't expect an AO, you know, who's supposed to read reports alone, to be fully responsible. You can't expect him to be in the front line watching a plane taking off and landing. So whether we can have the system in full operation in October, I do have a big question mark. You are only implementing the system partially now on alternative days and so forth. So when you can have a daily trial run of the system, and when would you have the trial run during rush hours now? Well, I think PS answered already, and he said that's part of the other kinds of work to be done by the DDG. Yeah, safety, who's responsible for safety, PS? I think as for the gradual implementation plan, the timetable involved, I think Mr. Chen was asking about the timetable. That will be decided upon by professional staff in the department. The new DDG will be on the basis of the timetable, whether they will have enough manpower and resources. Any other members with questions? If not, then I'll put this item to a vote. Those in favor? Do you want to claim a division? I was saying it. Voting begins. Before I announce the results, members, please verify your votes. Time's up. Please show the results. Of the 22 members present, 14 are in favor, 5 object to it, and 2 abstentions. So I announce that the item is endorsed. Okay, do you want to have a separate vote on it in Finance Committee? Okay. So next item, EC 2016-17, 5. Government Secretary, Overseas Economic and Trade Officers, they're recommending to Finance Committee the creation of a AOSGB, a permanent post in the Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office, to take charge of the new ETO to be set up in Jakarta. And they will actually delete a permanent post in the Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office in Washington D.C., AOSGB1. And also, they're asking for an increase in the establishment ceiling in terms of the total notional annual midpoint salary value of Head 96, Government Secretariat, Overseas Economic and Trade Offices from 81 million. By $1.9 million to $83 million in 2016-17 for creation of relevant non-directorate posts required for the new Hong Kong ETO office in Jakarta, and the restructuring of the directorate establishment of the Hong Kong Economic and Trade Office in Washington after the deletion of the AOSGB1 post. So with us today are the actually permanent secretary for Commerce and Economic Development, I think, Mr. Philip Young. Well, first of all, let me congratulate your promotion to D8. Also with us is DS for Commerce and Economic Development, Ms. Carol Yun, and Principal Executive Officer of the Commerce and Economic Development Bureau, Mrs. Susanna Kong. Mountain Kong. A briefing, right? Yes, the Commerce and Economic Development Panel in principle supported the creation of the new ETO in Jakarta and also restructure the ETO in Washington. Members urge administration to set up Hong Kong as a government and its networking points in the One Belt One Road region so as to foster economic benefits to be gained from the One Belt One Road initiative and to step up Hong Kong's trade links with the area. Besides that, members also urged administration to strive to sign the free trade agreement with ASEAN as soon as possible so that Hong Kong's cargo and services can enter the ASEAN markets and get a even better treatment. Members expressed concern that in some overseas countries with ETOs and Trade Development Council's offices, there could be an overlap of resources. And they thought that the TTC should concentrate on fostering trade in emerging markets. They suggested that the TTC offices could be relocated to other cities so as to broaden Hong Kong SAR's overseas network. Besides, there are also members who express concern about the problem of foreign domestic helpers. They thought that setting up the ETO in Jakarta, the office concern should also deal with matters related to foreign domestic helpers in Hong Kong who are from Indonesia. Thank you, Chairman. The first member to ask questions is Chen Chi-Chin, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Creating the post, well, I would just use for, well, it must be linked to One Belt, One Road. Therefore, countries along the area would need to be given more resources, and we are also setting up this ETO in Jakarta. But if you look at the paper, we can find that it's not just about opening an office. It's a big surgery indeed, because it involves the deletion of the DG role in the Washington office, and it needs to also curtail the powers of the Singapore ETO. So it's a restructuring. I'd like to thank the ETO in Singapore. Last trip, we went to Singapore to inspect the water supply system, and we were given care there by the ETO. And the ETO in Jakarta, the new head of it, will also, if my understanding is correct, he will also overlook the Singapore office. So could you explain to me, well, there will be no DG Washington ETO. Is it that another office head will be in charge of the Washington office matters then? And why do we have a Jakarta office looking over or monitoring the work in Singapore? P.S. Thank you. The new ETO to be opened in Jakarta, should it be approved by the Finance Committee, it will become our highest representative office in ASEAN. It would be like the headquarters, our headquarters in ASEAN. We have long-standing trade ties with ASEAN. It is a very important emerging market for us. The ETO Jakarta, its future head, will be in the at a D3 grade compared to the head in the Singapore office, who is in D2 grade. So the future head will be even of a senior position. Why? Well, besides our trade ties with ASEAN, the Secretariat of ASEAN is also based in Jakarta. Therefore, as I said, the new office will become actually the headquarters for our trade links with ASEAN, and the new head will be responsible for our entire relationship with ASEAN. After the office is established, it will actually have better division of job with the ETO in Singapore. The Jakarta ETO will be responsible for Indonesia, Malaysia, Brunei, and the Philippines. And the remaining six countries in ASEAN will be the responsibility of the Singapore ETO. So comparison with the Singapore ETO, well, the work in the future will be more focused, because the Singapore office will only focus on six areas.
So this will benefit the representatives, so our representativeness in Asian countries. So we propose to delete a default post in Washington to offset the creation of this D3 post in Jakarta. In Australia, we have a D6 officer heading our representation, our outreach, and our bilateral cooperation in the U.S. There is ETO in Washington, New York, and San Francisco. The scope of activities of the ETO in Washington is in communication with the U.S. Parliament, think tanks, and academic institutions there. So there is some overlap in roles and functions of these D3 with the D6 post in the U.S. So reviewed the situation, we believe that we should be more focused in our liaison work in the U.S. Given this situation, we believe that the D6 officer may not need the support of this D4 post. For better utilization of resources, we've decided to delete this D4 post in Washington to be offset by the D3 post in Jakarta, and is the current D6 post in the U.S. will be supported by other directorate posts in the U.S. This is a reasonable arrangement, and it's also better utilization of resources. It's my turn. It's about the Washington office. So you've deleted a default post. Does that mean that the D6 post will have to take up this? Is there an AOD2 post there? This default post will be deleted. The D6 post will be supported by a D2 post plus two SAOs and two deputy principal trade officers. So believe he should be sufficiently supported, and the utilization of resource and manpower is more rational. Well, this D3 post will be deleted in Washington. How many directorate officers there will be there in the U.S.? D6, the Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs, USA, supported by a D2 officer. And what about the Jakarta office? In fact, Indonesia is a very important market because as one of the most populated country among the Muslim countries. However, the post is created so late because many AOs do not like to be stationed there. So are you able to find people to mend the person to mend the post, or are you going to employ a retired officer who is mature enough to take up the job? Well, the recruitment of the head of Jakarta ETO is just like the recruitment for other heads of ETOs. So there is a D3 post, and with the passage of this paper, we will have a D3 post supported by one SAO and also other executive officers. We have one SAO and one EO who have already joined the team, and they are making the final preparation. And next week, they're going to fly to Jakarta to carry out the advanced work. And for recruitment of the D3 post, I understand that the recruitment exercise is complete, and we've already selected the right officer. But of course, out of respect for the council, we must wait for the approval of the council or by ESC and FC before we can confirm the appointment. So you have got an officer from the current civil service, not a retired officer to man the post, correct? Yes, we already identified the right candidates, but we have to wait until the ESC and FC have passed this paper before the appointment can be confirmed. Another issue, I agree with Mr. Wong Ting Kwong's report of the deliberations of the panel that the officer should, or the Jakarta office should deal with FDHs as well. But you do not have anyone from the immigration department. You have you have AOs, EOs, and also IOs, but not an immigration officer. So how are you going to tackle the issue of FDH, foreign domestic helpers, from the Indonesia? Yes, one of the duties of the office is to deal with FDHs. Please refer to para 10C. We do attach significance to the contribution of FDHs to our economy. So one of the duties of the officer is to liaise with the Indonesian government to consider related policies, and he is to carry out the preliminary liaison work. And he should also publicize in Indonesia so that people who aspire to become foreign domestic helpers in Hong Kong can have a better understanding of our situation here. So, as you said, Chairman, we haven't got anyone from the Immigration Department in the establishment there. However, the liaison with the Immigration Department is easy and close, and where necessary, the Jakarta office will seek the support of the Immigration Department, also enhance communication with the department. Ms. Wong Ting Kwong, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. as we all know, the market itself is also is very important to economic growth. So, of course, we should tap into new markets. ASEAN countries are very important markets, and we should have developed into these countries very early on. There won't be potential for substantial growth in European and U.S. markets. After all, we know the markets well already. And for ASEAN countries, they are new markets. And the industry has asked the administration to lead the industry to get familiarized with the people, culture, laws, and matters related to these countries, so that we can have better understanding of the markets there. And therefore, the industry really supports the setting up of new ETO in Jakarta, because the population is over 1 billion. In ASEAN countries. So we support this move. For government and quasi-government bodies such as the TDC have duplicated their resources. The industry wants the administration to be frugal and so long as they can get the job done. So, other than Washington, perhaps the ETO structure in other parts of the world should be reviewed in due course, so as to save resources as far as possible and redeploy the resources for development of new markets. So you don't really need any response. It's just an expression of opinion. All right, Dr. Fernando Zheng, 4 minutes. Thank you. The review would involve the deletion of a default post in Washington to be offset by the creation of a directorate post in Jakarta. I'd like to know for our trade, I'd like to know the percentage of a trade volume with ASEAN countries against our GDP, and also the relative figure for the US. And I understand that Vietnam accounts for the highest trade volume for Hong Kong, to be followed by Singapore. Indonesia is further down the list. So I'd like to know why is Jakarta chosen and not Vietnam? And why is the Singapore, why is the status of the Singapore ETO downgraded? And I'd like to know whether this Jakarta ETO will follow up on FDH matters. According to the Deputy Secretary or the Secretary or the PS, this will be the case. But I'd like to know the actual scope to be covered, because foreign domestic helpers have played a great role in releasing our labor force and promoting our economy. Well, the elderly and the kids and the chronically ill in Hong Kong are being taken care of by FDHs. And so foreign domestic helpers have contributed a lot to our economy, and they're very important. So what is the role of this Jakarta ETO? Do you have a breakdown of the contribution by ASEAN countries to our GDP? will we have the ranking? As for their contribution, respective contribution to our GDP, I don't have the information with me now, but I'll try my best. Thank you, Dr. Zhang, for your question. As far as I know, the 10 ASEAN countries together account for, or they are, the second largest trading partner of Hong Kong, or rather the fourth trading partner, but for freight, they rank second, and their position has been rising. So this is a very important potential market for us. Among the top 20 trading partners of Hong Kong, 5 of them are among the ASEAN countries. Singapore ranked the 5th, Thailand the 8th, Vietnam the 9th, Malaysia the 10th, the 11th, the Philippines the 14th or the 15th. Indonesia, for the time being, is not very high on the list. But why have we chosen Jakarta for the new ETO in ASEAN countries? Because the secretariat of ASEAN is in Jakarta, and all 10 countries of ASEAN countries have their consulates or ambassadors in Jakarta. So Jakarta is a good place for networking with ASEAN countries. And Indonesia also accounts for 40% of the total ASEAN population, as well as the total ASEAN GDP. The current trading volume with Hong Kong is not high, but that goes to show that it is a very big potential market which we should work hard to explore. We have not downgraded the status of the Singapore ETO. Rather, we want Singapore ETO to focus on the liaison and development in 6 countries. And as for FDH, once again, we confirm the recognize the contribution of FDH to our economy and community. This Jakarta ETO office will ensure a closer and more effective communication with the Indonesian government on such matters. The office will promote to the potential FDHs in Indonesia the culture, the laws, and the policies in Hong Kong so that they can more easily adapt to the environment in Hong Kong. For instance, their rightful interests, and to ensure that they would not be shortchanged by the employment agencies. Well, we are promoting this in Hong Kong, and in future, we will do more in Indonesia and the Philippines. I'm sure that will be more helpful. Mr. Yu Siwing, 4 minutes, first round. Thank you, Chairman. The government has adopted a macro perspective in rationalizing the resources. I think this is a good move. It would be desirable if other government departments follow suit. Yes, where it is necessary, posts should be created, but resources should be rationalized and saved in other areas. And I think this is a strategic move for further development in ASEAN countries. These countries are developing very rapidly. Why is it difficult to employ Indonesian helpers nowadays? Because the economy there is growing, and their people are getting have increased in their income, and therefore some of them may not be interested in working in Hong Kong anymore. So I think we should publish information related to Hong Kong in Indonesia more often. Paragraph 11. One of the work of the ETO there is to promote the image of Hong Kong. I am interested in this part because of my position in the tourism industry. However, it's not too clear in this paragraph as to how they can help to promote the tourism industry of Hong Kong here. I know that the TDC has got an office in Jakarta, the Tourism Commission has an office there. I'd like to know how the ETO can cooperate with the Tourism Commission and supplement its work so as to further boost the image of Hong Kong and develop our tourism industry. Mr. Yong, thank you. The 10 ASEAN countries, Indonesia in particular, have a lot of visitors to Hong Kong. And conversely, we also have a lot of Hong Kong people visiting these countries. So bilateral relations with these countries will be very important. And the actual work, of course, is always done by colleagues of the Tourism Commission. And our ETO will meet with the academic and political sectors of Indonesia. They have a wide scope of networking there. Of course, there is room for ETO and Tourism Commission to cooperate. And if the Tourism Commission needs our support in, for instance, enhancing the official participation of the activities, and they want the official support of Jakarta to their activities, I'm sure the ETO will work very closely to help. Chairman. I think these are rather vague replies. I hope they can give us some more specific targets. If we can develop different areas, then we will have more sources of tourists to Hong Kong. So, has the ETO and the Tourism Commission have specific targets for developing tourism industry in Indonesia? Thank you.
Well, if there are chances for cooperation, of course we will do that. But when it comes to the ETO's daily work, if it discovers that there are areas where the Tourism Commission can look into and develop markets, then of course the ETO will help the development of Hong Kong's tourism. Yang Kuo-hung, 4 minutes. Well, for Jakarta, the secretariat of the ASEAN is located there. So that's why you want to set up an ETO there, right? Is it because Jakarta is the location of the ASEAN headquarters? So that's why you want to send a representative there. Is that the reason? Well, when we choose Jakarta as our new ETO office city, that's one of our considerations. And now you are deleting a post in Washington. The Singapore ETC will be supervised by the Jakarta ETO. So what will happen to the staff at Singapore ETO? They would have to listen to the orders of Jakarta ETO. What are the relationship, Permanent Secretary? Well, for the head of the Jakarta ETO, he will be our top representative in ASEAN. So when it comes to working with ASEAN, he will be heading Jakarta ETO and Singapore ETO. And Jakarta ETO will be responsible for four countries, while Singapore ETO will be responsible for
another 6 countries. So Singapore can also enhance its liaison with the 6 countries. We think this is a good arrangement. So for Jakarta ETO, it covers Indonesia, Malaysia, Brunei, and the Philippines. And Singapore ETO, it covers Singapore, Cambodia, etc. But Singapore has a close relationship with us. At the same time, it's our competitor. So I don't understand why, after setting up the Jakarta ETO, Jakarta ETO and Singapore ETO are not on the same level. Instead, Jakarta ETO will be over Singapore ETO. Well, because that officer will be of a more senior rank. That doesn't mean anything, because Indonesia is not as advanced as Singapore, isn't it? P.S. And when it comes to our arrangements, we need someone to head the whole establishment. Now, to make it short, the ASEAN Secretariat is set up in Jakarta. It doesn't mean that Jakarta or Indonesia is leading the ASEAN economy. Do you know what I mean? So when it comes to economic volume, Indonesia is the biggest in ASEAN. Yes, because it accounts for 40% of the total GDP of ASEAN. How many people are there in Jakarta and how many people are there in Singapore? Well, if that is the case, then of course China is the strongest country in the world. We think that this is a good organization structure. That is, Jakarta will take the lead when it comes to ASEAN work. We still have 3 members who will ask their first round questions, Mr. Ip Kwok Him, Sin Chung Kai, and Alvin Yeo. Mr. Ip Kwok Him. Now, for the setting up of the new ETO, I support that. As for Singapore ETO, I have heard them about their work. They think that they are covering too broad a scope. Southeast Asia is an important partner of ours, so now we are adding a Jakarta ETC. I think that's appropriate. So when it comes to arrangements and which ETO is more or is the subordinate of another ETO, then I think this is an administrative arrangement. Now you are adding a post while you are deleting another post in Washington. So after the creation and the deletion of posts, what's the financial implication? Are you spending more or less? And secondly, now we have 11 ETOs. If we add Jakarta, then there will be a total of 12, right? So for this 12 ETOs, what are their staff ranks? Now in Washington, you have a D6 who's heading the office. As for Brussels and London, what are their ranks? Can you give us the information in this regard? So after creating the ETO in Jakarta, what's the rank of the head there? P.S. Thank you for your supporting question. Now we will be deleting a D4 post and creating a D3 post. So in terms of remuneration, we will save a bit. And one major consideration is that we have to use our resources carefully when it comes to the number of directorate posts. We have to be very careful. we need to listen to the logical and the public. We are very careful when we create directory posts. As for the existing 11 ETOs, there has other well include D6, D3, D4, D2. Most of the ETO has overseas D2 and D3. Other than the D6 and D4 officers, there are also other directory posts that are supporting their work. Who else is D6? Only one in Washington. And how about Geneva? Well, for the Geneva post, it's D4. So no others are at this level. For Brussels, it's D4. Mr. Xin Chengkai, 4 minutes. Last week, I just visited Brussels, and I visited your ETO there. Well, I do not have objection to this proposal. I think Indonesia is a developing economy, so I think setting up an ETO there is all right. But now you will be deleting a D3 post in Washington. At paragraph 13, you explained that because now there is a D6 leading the U.S. office. But I think that before the handover, it was D8. That's Asbury Rickham, right? Yes, you are totally right. It originally was D8 and now it's D6. And now you're also taking away some of his senior staff. Does it mean that the U.S. economy is not as important to Hong Kong as in the past? I do not object to the setting up of the ETC in Jakarta, but now you are deleting a senior post in Washington. The people now they have TPP and all kinds of economic arrangements. So do you think you have enough staff to take care of our economic and trade in the US? Thank you for your support and question. We have the confidence that after this restructuring, our Washington ETO and other ETOs can work as efficiently as before. As for our Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs, USA, now is D6. Even though we are deleting a D4 post now, there will still be a D2 officer supporting him. As for the US economy, is our second biggest partner. We attach a lot of importance to our economic and trade relationships with the US. We have a close liaison with the government and commercial sector. We know very well about their concerns. Even after deleting the post, we still have the confidence to work closely with them. For the Jakarta ETC, will there be our Labor Department staff? Our chair lady, Ms. Emily Lau, is very concerned about Indonesian domestic helpers. Last time we discussed this at the CI panel, for this new ETO, we have already taken this into account. That is, we will take care of domestic helper matters. But will there be a Labor Department representative? Well, if there's such a representative, maybe he doesn't have enough things to do. However, on the other hand, you may not know how to handle labor relationship. Well, it's very easy for us to liaise with all departments, so we don't really need a representative of the Labor Department there. If there is a need, we can ask the Labor Department to send an officer there for a while, but we think that the present arrangement would be effective. Mr. Ovanyang, I want to echo Mr. Sin's question. I am worried because the economic and trade relationship between the U.S. and Hong Kong is very important. It's our second biggest trading partner. And now you are changing the establishment. Would a D6 staff alone be able to deal with the heavy workload in Washington? We will have to liaise with a lot of people, political parties, governments, business sector, etc. And if he doesn't have a D4 to help him, is that okay? You are now still hiring lobbyists and consultants at Washington, right? Yes, you are right. Other than our ETO staff, we also have consultants and lobbyists in the U.S. They help us. Develop our relationship with the Congress, the government, and political parties. As for our Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs, USA, in the past years, he has done a lot of work. He's a leader when it comes to talking to the government. He would always lead a team to talk to the government. So even though we will delete the D4 post, there will still be a team to support him, and I'm sure he will be capable. The CS is visiting the U.S. this week, and she will be visiting a number of cities. The Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs will accompany her to visit government officials, etc., in the U.S. So her visit is organized by the commissioner. The work has been smooth so far. Of course, this is the job of the Commissioner for Economic and Trade Affairs. If the CS visits the U.S., so no matter whether he's pitched at D64 or D3, this is what he should do. As to whether the work has gone smoothly, of course, the CS would not make a complaint directly. So only afterwards can we find out whether the job has been properly done. So let me talk about the structure. Now the government is making such a change to the Washington ETO. Can other ETOs do the same? That is, can D4s be downgraded to D3s so that we can save money? Now, if this is feasible in Washington, how about other ETOs? Can they also downgrade their officers so that we can save money and develop other ETOs? P.S. Of course, we will be very prudent when it comes to using our resources, and we are very careful about our establishment ceiling. For the heads of ETOs, most of them are D2s, but we have some major trading partners, for example, the U.S., Brussels, and London, as well as Geneva, that post a D3. So we will monitor the situation very closely. If there is a need, we will make changes and we will make the most appropriate arrangements. Okay, second round, myself, 3 minutes. I support the creation of this post, PS, but I'm also concerned about the Washington ETO. In the past few years, when Hong Kong government officials visited the U.S., it seems that our counterparts were of lower ranks. Well, for the CS, is she going to Washington this time, and who will be receiving her? The CS will be going to Washington, but as for her detailed itinerary, I don't have it with me at this moment. We will arrange for her to see the highest level official possible. Other than the CS visits, every year our economic and financial officials will also visit Washington. So we attach great importance to our economic relationship with the U.S. Well, for the business sector is different because they have a role to play in IMF. So can you also give us more information about the CS visit this time, and what rank of officials will they be seeing? Giving it to the committee, well, subcommittee, of course, that they should give the information to the subcommittee, that is me. So I would know the rank, I would like to know the rank of the U.S. government officials that our CS is seeing. In October, every year, all our ETO heads will come back to Hong Kong to report to the CI panel on what they have done. I'm sure that in October this year, I can ask the relevant officials to give you detailed reports about the past year. Now, of course, I also support the development of our economic relationship with ASEAN. Just now, you have told us about Singapore's rank when it comes to trading. And now people have been talking about the Greater Mekong Delta. When it comes to service industry and cargo industry, it seems that they have huge potential. For example, Cambodia, they have a huge potential when it comes to the developments of more tourist destinations. China is also thinking of making more developments in these areas. So will you be setting up another ETO for the Mekong Delta? Well, of course, for Asian countries, they all have their potential, and we will be monitoring the situation very closely. There will be great markets. So after setting up the Jakarta ETO, the Singapore ETO can be more focused. It will be liaising with Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, etc. They would have extra resources and manpower to look at the second tier cities of these countries. As for other ASEAN countries, as to whether we will set up new ETOs, well, we will have to wait for the Jakarta ETO to run in, and then we will have other considerations.
First round, Chung Kok Pan, 4 minutes. As for the ETO in Washington, the changes there, I mean, changing of name doesn't matter, but in Washington, which is so close to Capitol Hill, and there are a lot of U.S. trade agreements, can we try to get more involved in them? Like, unfortunately, the TTP actually did not include Hong Kong, and Hong Kong could not negotiate to be part of it. TTP, next stage of development, whatever that will be, can you ask the office to pay attention to that? And if there's to be a second round of negotiations on the agreement, can the Hong Kong SAR government play a part in it and try to be involved in the agreement? TTP? PS? Yes, so the TTP, well, the Washington office, actually the head, Mr. Leung, he came back to brief electrical panel last year, and he took time to explain to members how the Washington ETO was monitoring the development of TTP. They'll continue with the work, and if necessary, we'll be happy to invite Mr. Leung to come back to Commerce and Economic Development Panel to share about the latest. Chairman, before he comes back, you know, can you brief us on the impact of TTP? That is, you can brief us at the Commerce and Economic Development Panel. We don't have to wait till Mr. Lam comes back. Chairman, I can provide you with an information paper, I think, for the next meeting of the Commerce and Economic Development Panel. I think the agenda is full, but we can provide you with the paper first for members' reference. Okay. Any other members who would like to ask questions? If not, I'll put this item to a vote. Those in favor, please raise your hands. Those who object, please raise your hands. So this item is approved. So do we need to have a separate vote on it in the Finance Committee? Okay, no such need? Okay, thank you. The next item then. The third item. EC 2016-17-6. Paper from the Department of Justice recommending to the Finance Committee the creation of a permanent post in the Legal Policy Division of the DOJ, a DPGC, Directorate Grade 2, DL2, and it will be a post to head a dedicated unit in arbitration. The administration consulted AJLS panel earlier. With us today is Mr. Alan Hsu, Director of Administration and Development from DOJ, Solicitor General of DOJ, Mr. Wesley Wong SC, and Deputy Solicitor General of the DOJ, Mr. Peter Wong, and Mr. Brian Lau, Assistant Solicitor General Legal Policy, DOJ. Thank you. And welcome you all. Mr. Martin Liu. Well, he's not here, so... At the AJLS panel, this item was discussed in March. So because the chairman is not here, so I'll brief you on the main points of the discussions by the panel. On March 21st, the AJLS panel discussed the creation of the permanent post in the Legal Policy Division of DOJ, a deputy principal government counsel to head a dedicated unit in arbitration. To take up the arbitration portfolio, and also the work will also help with devising derivative strategies and measures in promoting and developing Hong Kong's arbitration services in an increasingly competitive regional environment. Since the lawyers may not be adept at carrying out coordination and promotional work, so members suggested that the government should consider hiring more experienced people from outside the legal profession to promote Hong Kong's arbitration services. So the administration said that if needed, they could appoint consultants to do the promotion work. Okay, members with questions, Elvin Young. Thank you, Chairman. Just then, the Chairman briefed us on the views of the AJLS panel. So I'd like to ask the DOJ whether you've considered, that is, in the recruitment criteria, people with the relevant background. Because if the focus is too much on legal experience, then, well, the applicant may be very well-versed in legal matters, but lack experience in promotions or doing promotional work. Director, well, this is a civil service post, but our understanding is that the AJLS panel expressed concern that we could get someone with richer experience in promotional work. Indeed, in promoting arbitration, we actually did work together with non-official organizations like the TDC. The Trade Development Council helped us in promoting our arbitration services overseas. That is to let people know that Hong Kong can provide the services as a regional center. So maybe I'll ask Mr. Wong to give you the details. Thank you, the Chairman, and also thank you for the question. In the process of promoting the work, we actually have liaised with arbitration organizations like the Hong Kong International Arbitration Center and organizations with arbitration branches in Hong Kong. We work with them to promote our services. So the newly created post, besides promoting arbitration, it will also need to see how we can follow up legally on the promotion, on the development of arbitration in Hong Kong to tie in with the international trend. So there must be the involvement of a lawyer or barrister to do the job. But having noted members' views in our promotional work in the future, so as Mr. Su said, besides the TTC, we'll also, when necessary, find outside consultants. Like recently, when we were in Latin America, we helped the local consultants to help us coordinate the promotional work. We'll continue to pay attention to that. Chairman, I've also noticed that the starting salary for this post is not particularly high. I'm just worried that whether the DOJ is worried that, you know, you're talking about getting people from the private market, people with that experience and ability, their salaries will be much higher than what is offered here. So, Director, would you have the confidence to get the right person? Well, Director, what do you think of the competition with the private sector? As I said, this is a civil service post. We expect to recruit mainly from within the DOJ, you know, solicitors, lawyers in the department. So we are confident that we can find staff with enough experience to do the work. Okay, so he's confident. Okay. My question next. Director, when we were discussing the previous item about setting up the ETO of, in Jakarta, members asked about, you know, Singapore as a rival in ASEAN, including in the area of arbitration. Even though we are well known for our arbitration services, Singapore has actually taken quite a lot of business from us, and Singapore is really interested in doing arbitration. So having the D2 post, what strategies do you have to help us compete favorably with Singapore? As for competition from other places, we are very concerned about that. We know that in the Asia-Pacific region, we have a number of rivals, well, South Korea, Singapore, and so forth. They are competing head-on with us. So we will step up our promotional work and also follow up on the policies concerned. The paper recommends the creation of a directorate grade legal staff that is to beef up our software. And in terms of hardware, Gemma, you mentioned about the resource issue. We are promoting the concept of a legal hub. That is, after the DOJ has moved into the previous government headquarters, the West Wing, and the East Wing, we're renovating the West Wing now. And the previous Court of Final Appeal building will be preserved and renovated. And when that work is done, we will open up part of the previous Court of Final Appeal building and the West Wing. We will vacate areas there or space there to be used by legal organizations so as to provide the hardware to help promote Hong Kong as an international center for a legal center for resolving disputes. Okay, Chung Kong Pan, next, first round. I've got two questions. Of course, we support that, you know, Hong Kong being an in a center for resolving disputes in Asia-Pacific. If there are disputes that happen locally, then of course, naturally, Hong Kong should be the place where they are resolved or arbitrated on. But how about disputes that happen overseas? How can you attract people to come to Hong Kong to settle them? How are you going to go about with the promotion? My second question is, One Belt, One Road. The SAR government has been promoting One Belt, One Road, and that Hong Kong can export its services, professional services, to the more than 600 countries in the Belt and Road area. But how about arbitration? If you look at more than 60 countries in One Belt, One Road, even though those countries, their laws, their own domestic laws, are not in line with international norms. So how can you attract those countries to come to Hong Kong to get the service? Director, as for how we're going to attract overseas bodies to come to Hong Kong for arbitration, well, for foreign disputes, even they are foreign disputes, the parties concerned can choose to come to Hong Kong and adopt the laws here as the basis for arbitration. In terms of promotional work overseas, where we will promote the concept of the rule of law, the fact that Hong Kong has a very well-founded legal system, and arbitration centers can provide good facilities for overseas cases to come here for arbitration. As for One Belt, One Road, as mentioned in the paper, it will, of course, the initiative will bring new opportunities for us, and we hope that we can tap the market there. The paper says that, well, there's the Asian Development Bank, Investment Development Bank project, and the parties involved can, if should there be any disputes, they can try or choose to come to Hong Kong to settle the disputes. As for Central Asia, we have communicated with the countries there, introducing to them our arbitration services. Kazakhstan, for example, has been in contact with us, and if there's any new development there in terms of training, we ask and we've discussed with them Hong Kong being a provider of training for the country. Well, is that the Hong Kong has its advantages. For example, our rule of law, our sound legal system, but Singapore can say the same thing, exactly the same thing. So how do we know that we have an edge over Singapore? And also, just as you said, Kazakhstan, for example, well, how about the language used there? It's different from the languages used in Hong Kong. And we don't have talents who can translate their languages or their documents. How are we going to let them understand our system here? I think that's language is a big barrier. How are we going to overcome that? Yes, how are we going to compete with Singapore, Director? Let me give you some information for reference. Actually, internationally, surveys have shown that which countries which countries have edges in arbitration, and an international survey showed that Hong Kong is ranked number 3 internationally, just behind Paris and London. As for Kazakhstan, maybe who can supplement? Mr. Wong, Kazakhstan, well, has been in contact with us. Of course, there are language barriers to be overcome, but we need to understand as well that the country is developing their international or services in resolving international trade disputes. The country does hope to use English and common law as their basis for in settling international disputes and providing financial services. So we are in close contact with them to see if we can provide any assistance and see how we can collaborate together. First round of questions, Chen Chichun, 4 minutes. I just want to ask about intellectual property protection. The policy address said that it wants to elevate Hong Kong into an international center for arbitration in cases of intellectual property violations and to amend relevant laws. Paragraph 70 of the paper is says that there is a working group set up, and the
Special Working Group published a consultation paper in December 25 in relation to arbitrability of IP rights. So what's the progress so far, and what do you think? How can we enhance Hong Kong's status in resolving disputes involving IP rights through amending or the laws? Who would answer? Mr. Wong? Well, earlier we did carry out a consultation, and during the consultation, we informed and briefed the relevant panel and or the working group. And after consultation, we received a lot of responses, most of which were supportive of our plan. And also, for the amendment bill, on our amendment bill to be introduced, the respondents gave a lot of constructive opinions. We are now in discussion with our colleagues in the law drafting section to see how we can incorporate them into the proposed amendment bill. I am the chairman of the working group, and the group will continue to convene. Indeed, this week we're going to meet again. We will further study the bill. We plan to actually in the next fiscal year, that is 2016-17, we hope that within the year we can submit the amendment bill to LegCo. Hopefully, the relevant amendments could be submitted in time. And because we are clear now that IP disputes can be resolved through arbitration, given that we can promote actually more overseas parties using Hong Kong as the center for arbitration of IP rights, and through the relevant international conventions, I think the result or the decisions of the arbitration can be applied overseas, and that will attract more people abroad to come here for arbitration. So, Director, can you give us more on details on your direction for amending the law? What are the limitations now, and what can we do in the future?
Mr. Wong, thank you. The restrictions are in different jurisdictions. There are arguments as to whether IP disputes can be resolved through arbitration. The law in Hong Kong is silent on this, so to clearly state that an IP dispute can be resolved by arbitration, we will enact a piece of legislation to say that even though a dispute involves IP right, that doesn't mean that it cannot be resolved by arbitration. This is to clarify the legal situation in Hong Kong so that parties to a dispute can feel assured that they can settle the arbitration in Hong Kong. Do you have any legislative plan? We hope to introduce the bill at the start of the next legislative year. The bill is already drafted. Well, the consultation document contains the draft bill as well, and therefore respondents were able to give us very constructive views on recommendations, so we can direct our legal drafting colleagues to fine-tune, refine the bill, and have it improved. Now, we have already had, we've already met for 2 hours, so we will take a break after we are done with this paper. Mr. Chong Kwok Pan, thank you. Mr. Greg So, the Secretary said that Hong Kong can be an IP trading hub, but as we all know, the Copyright Amendment Bill has not been passed, and we don't know when it can be passed. And Mr. So said that it was a big obstacle to our developing Hong Kong into an IP trading hub. So Mr. Wong just told us that the IP-related legislation would be amended, but IP rights and copyrights are in fact, two things very closed. So if you are stuck with the copyright amendment bill and you work with IP right first, what can you really achieve and what is the implications? I think IP rights is not just about copyright, right? We now focus on the arbitration ordinance, and that is any disputes involving IP rights, whether it be in Hong Kong or overseas, can be settled by arbitration in Hong Kong. So from an arbitration point of view, it is something neutral. We intend to provide arbitration service not just for local cases. If overseas litigants would like to find a neutral party to resolve their dispute by arbitration, they can do so in Hong Kong. So we hope that the law can help to clarify the legal position. The more the better. We've also got the blessing of the relevant panel for things to be done as soon as possible. What about the impact of the aborted copyright amendment bill? I understand that the copyright amendment bill is about the local copyright situation. I think the Bureau will monitor the progress. But from a resolution point of view, our focus is on copyright of all places. And as the Chairman said, in addition to copyright, all IP right disputes. Now, if the relevant parties would like to find a neutral place for settling the dispute, and if Hong Kong offers a good service, we hope they can choose Hong Kong. So this bill is important because we should amend the relevant ordinance ASAP. Yes, I understand that you're seeking to amend the arbitration ordinance, but if our copyright legislation is behind, is lacking behind, then people may choose Singapore instead of Hong Kong because the current copyright legislation was enacted in the 1990s, and we're in the 2016 already. Well, we want to thank LegCo. Just last week, patents amendment ordinance was enacted. I think there's a message sent to the world that Hong Kong attaches or respects IP rights. Any other questions, members? We don't have a quorum. Any other questions? Do we have questions? And I'll put this item to the vote, but we don't have a quorum, so we have to ring the bell. We'll put this item to the vote when we have formed a quorum.
We have a quorum.
All right, members, please be seated. I'll now put this item to the vote. Members, please return to your seats. Paper EZ 2016-17. Creation of a post in the D of J. For those in favor, please raise their hands. For those against, raise their hands. No objection. The paper is passed. Do you want to vote on it separately in the FC? No? Then we take a break of 5 minutes.